Welcome to Plus TV. Today we have Mark Okada from Highland Capital Management, registered investment advisor based in Dallas, Texas, with roughly $19 billion in assets under management. Mark, you specialize in credit, and you started your firm in 1993. You also run a mutual fund platform. Can you introduce yourself and your firm and talk about why you started your firm in 93?
It's been almost 20 years since we started our firm. Next year we'll have our 20-year anniversary. So back in 1993, if you remember, I bet you were pretty young then, but we were coming out of the S+L crisis still. The S+L crisis happened in the late 80s. And at that time, you had a banking crisis that was forcing banks to be selling assets. And if you think about wanting to start an investment management practice or getting into the asset management business, you want to be buying things at the wrong price. You want to be buying them at a price lower than the real true value. And regulated entities, when they're forced to sell things, are usually good places to buy things from in that genre, where you're buying things that are very cheap. And that's kind of the environment where we got started. Jim Dondero and myself started the firm in 93. We had a parent called Protective Life Insurance Company out of Birmingham, Alabama. We were doing a good job managing their capital, and they decided to help us launch an asset management business in 93. That business was unique in that we were managing their money for just our salaries. That was our initial remuneration. When you think about what's happening in the space today, where these private equity guys and hedge fund guys make so much money, our upside in the short term was to keep our jobs. And what would happen with our deal is that if we attracted more capital and grew the asset manager, then we would have upside. So there was a true alignment of interest in how we started our firm. If Protective had a good experience, we had a good experience. If they had a bad experience, we were out of the job. So we had this true alignment of interests. It helped us start the firm. It's been critical to the way we think and have grown the firm. It's what really drives us as a firm, even today. And so that's how we got started in 93. It was as a combination of good timing, good parent, but really this concept of treating the money like our own, having a good alignment of interest with our investor, and making sure that they had a good experience so we could have a pretty good one ourselves. We focused on a place where if we worked really hard, we thought we could add a lot of value for our investors. And credit is an area where you're lending money and getting it back. And knowing about your borrower and knowing more about your borrower tends to be very additive to your portfolio. So credit research and hard work can be actually very additive and a competitive advantage for managers. So we started out in the credit space, especially in bank loans. And bank loans were an asset class that at the time were really just traded between banks. And banks really didn't trade that much. They were buy and hold animals. They'd make a loan, they'd hold the loan, hopefully it would pay off. And that's how that asset class was working. We had this vision to turn the bank loan space into a true fixed income alternative asset class. And so that's kind of how we started the firm, as far as having a shingle, something that was unique, was a focus on bank debt. Today, it's a huge asset class. It's over $1 trillion. There are hundreds of market participants. So the firm today is about $19 billion in assets under management. We have about 140 people. We're headquartered in Dallas, Texas. We have offices in New York, in London, in Brazil, in Korea, and in Singapore. And one of the reasons why we've been, I think, fairly successful is we've stayed with that idea of alignment of interest, and we've expanded, and we have a pretty broad reach. We have a lot of investors around the world that trust us with their capital to treat it like it's our own and to grow. And so as I go through the things that we're doing today in our assets under management, the idea that I think is important is we don't do anything just because we're getting fees or that's where money is flowing or that's a hot idea. The only thing that we do as a firm is where we like the arbitrage and we think we can add value with our platform in that arbitrage. We may see arbitrage that we think is cheap and it's great and it's underpriced, but we don't have any people that know how to do that. That's not what we're going to do. Those are the two things that really are our discipline and making sure that we grow our firm in a prudent manner.
Mark, you did the first CLO in 1996. Talk about your reasoning for that first launch and how the asset class has grown.
When we got started, there were only a couple players that weren't banks that were buying and trading bank debt. There were a few mutual funds and then us. And so today, to move something from an asset class that really doesn't trade into something that is a true asset class where you have buyers and sellers and a lot of activity, it takes a lot to happen. And one of the big pivotal moments for our firm is we did the first CLO in 1996. And the CLO is a really great funding mechanism. If you can come up with one great idea, a CLO is a great idea. What a CLO is it's like a bank where you have loans in the asset side, and your balance sheet, instead of deposits and the equity in a bank, is debt that you raise in the CLO market. The big differential between bank and a CLO is not on the asset side per se, but more on the liability side. That those deposits that a bank have are both its lifeblood, but also its Achilles heel. If you have a run on a bank, you're out of business. And the problem with banks is their liabilities are much shorter in duration than their assets. A CLO is just the opposite. With that funding that we raise in the CLO market is a 10, 12 year maturity bond. So we borrowed the money in that space for a very long period of time. Our loans on the other side are about 2 or 3 years on average in their duration. So we have a just the opposite structure. And then we did the first deal in 96. Today, CLOs represent about 50, 60% of the market participants within the loan asset class. So it's gone from nothing to a very large business, and it's growing dramatically. And we're very fortunate to be the first player in that space. Along the way, we've branched out into other things. You mentioned earlier that we were going to talk about our retail business. We always wanted to get into that space. One of the things that you probably understand is that the retail investor usually gets the worst performance and pays the most fees. That's just the reality of how that asset class is, that investor's been treated over time. And we always felt that if we could provide them with world-class institutional-level investment management, that they would flock to our doors, that we would have this business that would grow and be a very good value add, where we were aligning interests, we were being very sincere, charging lower fees than the competition, but more importantly, giving them a better investment experience. But it really didn't matter when we started getting into it. All they cared about, as far as the distributors of those products, was whether you had a name. And no one knew who Highland was. We didn't have a pedigree. We didn't have a brand. And so it was very difficult. But about 10 years ago, we bought our way into the business. So we bought a couple mutual funds. We bought the mutual fund business from Fleet Bank when they merged with B of A. And that really got us into that business. So it's been a good 10 years. There's been a lot of growth that we've experienced, a lot of setbacks, but that's another big part of our business that's been growing over the years. And it's very important when we look forward as for our future.
So tell us about the range of strategies that you're currently running.
When we look at the bank loan space, we have bank loans in all different flavors, in CLOs, in separate accounts, within mutual funds, across the board. We want to provide that asset class to investors. It's a great asset class. It provides floating rate, senior secured, very good risk and good yield for those investors. And it's only going to be more important going forward. So that's a business for us. About $13 billion of our assets under management are in the CLO space. So we are the largest U.S. player in that space. We're the first one. So that makes sense that we're the largest also. We are growing our private equity activity across the board. Our private equity funds are in the distress control space, where you're buying up the debt of a company, You hope that that company can turn it around and pay you off at par, but if they can't, you are going to be comfortable in owning that company and turning it around. There's a lot of complexity and value that you can add to your investors because you're entering into a really messy situation. You're bringing your management skill and your expertise in being able to source the debt well and then turn the company around and really creating a very high return for your investors over a decent period of time. And then the other thing we do in private equity is called Falcon. This is where we're buying up oil and gas producing properties. It may sound like a tangent from the credit world that we deal in, but it's very math driven. It's very much a function of assessing what the property is doing, how much capital the property needs, how do we pull those resources up out of the ground and make good returns doing that. We focus on the smaller end of the space, and we've been making very good returns in that space. It's very value added. It goes back to this idea that we want to add our skill to the existing arbitrage, and we do that very well in that space. So that's our private equity business. We're really bullish on that going forward. One of the other big parts of our business is separate accounts. Separate accounts are where you're providing a solution within the alternative fixed income space to larger investors who are looking out at the world and saying, I need yield, I need safe yield, but I also need nimbleness or flexibility. A lot of large investors have no ability to be tactical. They're strategic in their asset allocation, but they just don't have the staff or the view into the space to be able to be tactical and nimble across their asset allocation. So in our separate account business, we can tailor solutions for those types of investors to say, we're good at doing loans and high yield and structured products and stress and distress. We'll take that capital and apply it in a separate account structure with your risk parameters that you're comfortable with and with customized reporting, et cetera, et cetera. I have 90 people in our back office, accountants, settlement people, lawyers, compliance, that can create that sort of transparency they need for a business like this. But it's really growing for us because we can give them solutions that give them the type of yield they need within alternative fixed income and provide them with that flexibility across asset allocation between the different asset classes. So it's a real value add for larger investors. And then the other areas of our business that are important are our retail business that we talked about. As we look at that, we want to bring this and be in front of this massive activity of capital coming out of traditional asset classes. You think about the equity market, how volatile it's been, and how difficult it's been to call that equity market. There's never been a worse performance period than the last 3 years for active managers in the hedge fund space, in the mutual fund space. They really have not been able to call where the equity market's going. It's been very volatile, it runs up in their face, and so that's a real problem. And investors are reacting with their feet. They're voting to get out. You've seen consistent outflows out of equities by both institutional and retail investors. A lot of this happens to coincide with the graying of the United States and the baby boomers retiring. They don't need as much risk in equities, but I think it's more a function of the fact that that market's been so hard to perform in. Flip side, when you think about fixed income, where are yields today? Yields are at zero almost everywhere you look. And those yields have come down so hard, but not in the traditional way. They've come down in a way that's been fairly artificial as far as how they've been reducing. The central banks around the world have been flooding the market with liquidity and creating very low interest rate policies. The Fed normally acts in the front end of the curve. Today, we've got the Fed acting in the front end of the curve, the end of the curve with Operation Twist. They're also buying mortgage backs now, which is an unbelievable change in what they're doing with the Fed's balance sheet. They've actually crossed the line and getting out of buying just Treasury, and now they're buying mortgage backs. They're entering into a capital market. And so you have this situation in fixed income where there's so many unknowns and so little confidence and still so little yield that investors are looking at that now and saying, why should I be exposed to that when at some point rates are going to go up and they know they're going to have problems? So money is flowing out of that. And where is this money flowing? If it's coming out of equities and fixed income, it's going into alternatives. Alternatives are a very good source of hopefully uncorrelated, lower volatility, absolute return. And that's what we want to provide. One of the areas where it's just getting started, institutions are pretty good at doing this, but retail investors are starting to get the joke around needing to have alternatives in their portfolios. But it's very hard to do it because there's a lot of education you have to do to be a retail investor investing in something that you're not really comfortable with. An alternative sounds kind of opaque and sophisticated. And so we've spent 10 years, as I said, in this business, educating those investors, providing them with good products that are good solution products that really align our interests. But I'm really excited about that part of our business.
So tell us more about Pyxis, your alternative mutual fund, and what that offers investors.
So within our retail complex, it's called Pyxis. Pyxis is our brand within the mutual fund space. We're providing long-short equity, which has been a very difficult spot in the institutional side, but we've been doing a very good job and have a fund of the year in that space. We've also have a credit business there within the mutual fund space, doing bank debt, doing also a multi-strategy sort of hedge fund-like activity within a closed-end fund. And so we're bringing our credit products into the space, and that's been doing very well. We have the number one performing fund in the mutual fund bank loan space. And we're also bringing in other types of alternative products. We have a long-short healthcare equity business. We have alternative fixed income products. We're bringing in other macro sorts of products into the platform, but we're just getting started. We're going to grow this business. We've revamped the management team there, and I'm really excited about how Pyxis is going to be growing. The last thing, and maybe the most traditional thing that people think about when they talk about alternatives, is hedge product. And we have long-short credit, we have long-short equity, as I mentioned. And as we think about that business today, it is a good business, and I think we do it very well. Credit hedge funds have done much better than equity hedge funds. There's a reason for that. The correlation that we see on equities in a risk-on, risk-off world, where a correlation is so much higher, make it very hard for long-short equity players to really add that non-correlated absolute return to investors. And so that business for us is not necessarily going to be a massive growth opportunity for us, although we are doing it very, very well. The other side of the coin, where we're focused on credit assets, where with credit you have a coupon, you have maturity, you have collateral, you have an indenture, you have a lot of things that can drive value that are fundamental, that are structural, as opposed to a valuation-based long-short structure. So we like that business going forward. It's been a good business. It's performed very well over the last 3 years, as opposed to what's happening in long-short equity. And we expect that to be the heart of our hedge fund business going forward.
So tell us how retail investors are responding to Pyxis, the alternative mutual fund. Are they actually getting what's alternative about this alternative mutual fund?
Well, one of the things that's important to understand about the mutual fund business in the U.S. is it's bifurcated into two very large pockets of capital. The wirehouses have very good institutional research and platforms to provide access to alternatives for their investors. They have very good tools to provide that sort of education for the end user through their systems, through programs, and that's really evolved well. So we match up great with that type of investor, where a Merrill Lynch or a B of A or a JP Morgan, they have sophisticated research, good strategy people that help investors get into the right types of alternatives. The other side of the coin that we see as a real opportunity for this type of investing is with the RIA channel. So the evolution across the financial advisors has gone away from your traditional stockbroker that was getting fees for every trade that they were doing, more to a much more sincere relationship where the IRA gets a flat fee and they're much more of a consultant in doing asset allocation and helping individual investors set their portfolios up in a way that makes sense to them. So we think that those investors are more sophisticated than your typical FA. And so we are engaging them with our platform. Pyxis has 10 wholesalers and a fairly big staff. We're covering the country and talking to all of these resources. We do a good job of providing a lot of research to that channel, of having conferences and white papers and a lot of research that shows them the value of alternatives. What's a bank loan? Why should I own a bank loan? Why does that make sense in this context? Should I be getting in? I hear about it's a bubble, et cetera, et cetera. We give them the right sort of answers to have transparency. I think that's the critical key for almost all investors to hear, not just the retail investors. Transparency has been something that's been missing within the alternative space. And it will come. It will either become because people like us focus on providing that transparency for their investors, or we're going to get it through regulation. One of the big things that I hear as a criticism of the hedge fund space is just how opaque it is. The unknowns about what's really going on within a hedge fund are one of the worries that will always be an impediment to its growth and to those investors having exposure to a very good activity, I think. Hedge funds are supposed to be lower volatility. They're supposed to be less risk than a traditional long-only exposure. So, but that's not perception. That is certainly not what people think about when they hear the word hedge fund. They think risk. They think high volatility of returns, which is not the case. And we have to play a good role in being transparent in that with all of our investors, whether they're sovereign wealth funds or whether they're your parents or you.
You also launched the second ETF in the bank loan space. Talk about that product and why you launched.
We're also providing some beta products. These products I'm talking about are all alpha products. We like the arbitrage. We're going to add value to that. That's the alpha part. We're also doing some beta products there. We launched the second ETF in the bank loan space called SNLN, Senior Loans. And it's based on the 100 most liquid loans in the space. So it's a great way for investors to get exposure that asset class. And ETFs are a big topic that everybody talks about. If you have a good asset class, a good beta stream, and you put it into an ETF, I think that's a really good tool to have for investors going forward.